Diabetic ketoacidosis remains the major cause of death in children with diabetes, and it is unfortunately still observed in a large majority of children who present to us in resource poor countries. Careful and appropriate management of DKA is essential to save lives of millions of children with diabetes. So I'll start off with this case and see how things and managements have changed over the last decade. So this was a 10-year-old child with severe DKA with sugars of 600, pH of 6.94, a very low bicarbonate and potassium of 5.5. Now if you go by the standard management textbooks of the last 10 years maybe, you will find the management would include giving a bolus of around 20 ml per kg, giving insulin bolus of around 0.1 unit per kg, giving bicarbonate because the pH is less than 7.1, and not adding potassium. So this is a standard management which we would have found in most pediatric textbooks maybe a decade ago. But unfortunately in this case, we had a very tragic event of sudden respiratory arrest and death. So what went wrong in this situation? I'll go back to this case again later on. But clearly, all the four lines of management were inappropriate given the recent protocols as far as DKA management are concerned. We gave too much fluid to begin with. Insulin bolus was given, which is not recommended anymore. Bicarbonate was given, which is now considered to be lethal. And a potassium was not added despite significant intracellular deficit are the key areas which would have caused problem for this child. And the cause of death in this child could have been cerebral edema or severe hypokalemia. So we'll just over the next 20-25 minutes or so discuss about the diabetic ketoacidosis of what, when and how of DKA. And the most important aspect to understand is the pathophysiology of DKA. Under most situations, there is a precipitating factor in the form of infection, stress or trauma, which tilts the management in a diabetic child, which may be a first presentation, or somebody who has been stable on insulin and suddenly had these factors, which results in two key pathophysiological changes as far as DKA is concerned. The most important obviously is the insulin deficiency, but excess of counter-regulatory hormones also plays an important role in the form of high growth hormone, cortisol and glucagon level. Insulin deficiency is responsible for enhanced lipolysis, which produces more fatty acids and ketones, and this ketogenesis is responsible for the ketosis and fruity odor, as well as acidosis, which causes abdominal pain and classical breathing, which is present in a child with DKA in the form of acidotic breathing. Counter-regulatory excess, on the other hand, causes glycogenolysis and gluconeogenesis, increasing the blood levels of glucose to a large extent, and therefore it causes effects of hyperglycemia in the form of osmotic diuresis, resulting in significant depletion of sodium, potassium and phosphorus along with dehydration. So DKA basically is a composite of both insulin deficiency and counter-regulatory excess, and therefore we need to keep this in mind in terms of management. So what do you expect in a child with DKA with regards to the fluid and electrolyte? So what we clearly see is that there is a significant fluid deficit of 5 to 10%. But it's important to understand that because of the clinical condition, because of the rapid breathing, because of the dryness of the tongue, we often tend to overestimate dehydration in a child with DKA. And this may have implications because then you're pushing more fluid and pushing that child towards cerebral edema. What about sodium? There is a significant deficit of sodium in a child with DKA, but because hyperglycemia itself causes hyponatremia, if you have a child with DKA, we tend to overestimate the sodium deficit, and therefore we need to correct the sodium for the level of glucose, which we'll discuss in a couple of minutes. Potassium, there is a significant intracellular deficit in a child with DKA. But because of insulin deficiency and acidosis, all the potassium from the cells actually migrates outside. So the actual measured blood potassium may in fact be low, normal or high. So one needs to be careful to remember that as soon as we start treatment with insulin, As soon as we correct acidosis, all this potassium will go into the cells and there would be severe hypokalemia. So every child with DKA requires potassium supplementation unless the potassium is more than 6, or the child is not producing urine, or the child has ECG changes of hyperkalemia. On the contrary, if we have a rare situation of a child who presents to us with hypokalemia at the diagnosis of DKA, this is a dire emergency, because as soon as we start treatment with insulin, the child will really crash with hypokalemia. So unless and until potassium levels are more than 3.5, we should not start insulin in DKA. And this is what we need to remember, is that there is a subtle balance about the risk of hypokalemia, which will be much more than the risk of maybe a slight clearance of hyperglycemia, which will take a bit longer if we do not start insulin. In that regards, hypokalemia takes precedence. So if you have a hypokalemic child with DKA, please do not start insulin, because that could be a lethal situation. Similarly, the phosphorus deficit is quite significant, and this may play a role in the form of causing lactic acidosis by reducing the oxygen delivery capacity, and we need to really assess and consider it if we have significant hypophosphatemia. Very severe levels of phosphate deficit can result into rhabdomyolysis, which can further trigger renal failure, and this could be a challenging condition to look into in this regard of DKA management. Now, what we need to remember is that when we are actually assessing any situation in DKA, we need to keep in mind the changes, the physiology of that. And in this regards, for fluid assessment, it's extremely important to assess it appropriately. And I would say the rule of thumb is that assess the level of dehydration and go a level below. So you assume that you are overestimating and get down. If you want to have further clarity regarding the level of dehydration or assessment, uric acid and blood urea nitrogen are quite helpful, because if there is hypovolemia, the uric acid levels will be quite high. Whenever we are measuring sodium levels, we need to correct it for hyperglycemia. For every 100 mg per dl rise or 5.5 millimoles per liter rise in blood glucose, the sodium level goes down by 2 millimoles per liter. So we need to correct it in the form of corrected sodium. And this is one of the most important figures to follow in a child with DKA. If a child with DKA is showing a declining trend of corrected sodium, this could be one of the first signs that the child is going to develop cerebral edema. Because what is happening is that while glucose is falling, the sodium is not rising. The osmolarity is really coming down, and we need to be very careful in that individual. Similarly, for potassium, for every 0.1 drop in pH because of metabolic acidosis, the potassium levels falsely elevates by 0.6. So this will really help us in estimating what the true level of potassium is in this regard. So if you have a pH of 6.9 and you have a potassium level of actually 5.5, what you're looking at is that you're actually staring at a deficit of around 3 millimoles per liter of potassium, because as soon as you correct the acidosis, potassium is going to go into the cells. So you need to be very careful in terms of assessment of potassium and sodium in this regarding DKA management. So now we know about what the next issue is, when to suspect diabetic ketoacidosis. And this is the crux, because this is a do or die matter. If you diagnose DKA, the child will be safe. If the diagnosis is not made, the child will actually have a significant problem in terms of mortality. So DKA should be suspected in every child who presents to us with dehydration with polyuria. Every child who is dehydrated should actually not be passing urine. But if somebody is dehydrated and passing a lot of urine, it means that it's the urine output which is causing the dehydration. And this could happen in the setting of diabetic ketoacidosis, adrenal insufficiency, tubular necrosis, or diabetes insipidus, but DKA will be on the top of the list. If a child has tachypnea without chest signs, or unexplained encephalopathy, or acute abdomen, always consider DKA is a possibility. DKA can also have high levels of amylase and lipase, so often a false diagnosis of pancreatitis is made when actually it is DKA in this setting. So how do you diagnose DKA? It's very simple. We're talking about three terms of diabetes. So you need to have a blood sugar levels more than 200, ketosis, and in this regards, blood ketones are definitely what's more important if the levels are more than 3, and acidosis in the form of pH levels which are in the acidotic range. We make a diagnosis of DKA. Always remember that urine ketones are unreliable markers because they are measuring acetoacetate, and the ketones formed in DKA are actually beta hydroxybutyrate. Moreover, if urine ketone strips are kept for a long time, they are unable to read even the acetoacetate. So urine ketones are unreliable marker for DKA, and that's why all of us should shift towards blood DKA, blood measurements of ketone, which is the beta hydroxybutyrate measurement. And now we have machines which actually measure beta hydroxybutyrate in a very reliable fashion. And if the levels are less than 0.6, it's considered to be normal. More than 0.1.5 is suggestive of ketosis, and more than 3 are diagnostic of diabetic ketoacidosis in this regards. So now we'll see through a few cases and see whether this child actually fits into DKA or not. So we have a 12-year-old girl who presented with bronchial asthma, respiratory distress, was very sick, presented with severe asthma and shock, was given steroids, beta agonists and fluid. And then somebody thought this could be DKA and did a measurement of sugar which was 320, had metabolic acidosis, and a diagnosis of DKA was established. But is it DKA? So we have found there is diabetes, there is hyperglycemia in a way, and there is acidosis. But what about ketosis? And what we find that there is no ketosis in this situation. So this is not diabetic ketoacidosis. This is stress hyperglycemia, which basically may be a precursor of development of diabetes later on in life, but at the moment the child is not diabetic in this regards. What about this 13-month-old boy with failure to thrive who presented with dehydration, metabolic acidosis and fluctuating blood sugar levels between 90 to 34 without receiving any insulin, and the blood ketones were positive? And this situation is rare because usually when you find DKA, you find the levels to be very high as far as sugars are concerned. Euglycemic DKA can occur in pregnant individuals, in children who have recurrent vomitings, and rarely somebody is treated with SGLT2 inhibitors, but it's otherwise unheard of as far as pediatric practice is concerned. So if you have severe acidosis with mild hyperglycemia, think of other possibilities, and organic acidemia are clearly one of those possibilities in this regards. So now we have talked about the what and when of DKA. The next issue is how do we approach and manage a child with diabetic ketoacidosis. So let's go back to this original case in which the child was managed as far as decade-old guidelines for DKA are concerned, and the child actually had a very poor outcome. So what happened wrong is that we gave too much fluid. We gave an insulin bolus which was not required. Bicarbonate, which is now contraindicated, was given. And potassium should have been added, was not added in this situation. And that could really cause a big problem in this regards. And that's why this child had a sudden respiratory arrest. Now we have different guidelines which have come in regards to the ISPAD guidelines, the BSPED guidelines, which actually talk about very restrictive fluid management, which have dropped down the fluid requirements to a significant level and simplify it. And recently the Indian Society of Pediatric Endocrinology has also come up with its second set of guidelines for management of DKA. So the initial management of DKA is as for any other acute condition, starts with an assessment for airway, which would start off ensuring that there is a secure airway. Always put NG aspiration. If somebody had a lot of sugary feed, it's always better to actually drain that, because that will help us in preventing further hyperglycemia to happen. Look at breathing, and often these children look quite sick, but please be wary of doing a very quick intubation. Children with DKA improves dramatically with management. Intubation may actually temporarily cause increase in CO2, resulting in further exacerbation of cerebral edema. So intubation should be deferred unless and until a child is in a very dire state. Similarly for circulation, fluid is thin, but not to a very aggressive manner. And one very important message is to avoid putting central lines in a child with DKA, because there is a high risk of thrombosis, and these children can actually develop venous thrombosis and embolism, and which can cause real mess as far as management are concerned. Always ensure that you have two IV lines, one to give the fluids, antibiotics and other stuff, and a separate dedicated insulin line, because otherwise if you use the same line and you're giving some antibiotic, you're giving some other infusion, the insulin may be interrupted and that will cause fluctuations in blood sugar in this situation. Start off with laboratory assessment, and the few pointers which will help you is the anion gap, which tells us in a way the severity of DKA. Corrected sodium is a clear-cut marker which will help us predict the development of cerebroedema. Our aim is to maintain corrected sodium at an appropriate level. Plasma osmolality again, which tells us about the marker of severity, and if you have a high osmolality, that individual needs to be managed carefully because they have a high risk of developing cerebroedema. Please monitor these individuals carefully. Slow the fluid rate. Correct it over 72 hours. Otherwise, this child will develop more problems in this regards. Blood count will often show you leukocytosis, but that is not an evidence of infection. What should make you worry when you have a child who comes to you with DKA diagnosis? Children with DKA have hemodynamic instability, but if somebody has shock, then you should keep your eyes and ears open to the possibility of a serious infection, cerebroedema, or other complications in this regards. Fever is unusual in DKA, so if you are having high grade fever, then consider the possibility of having... If a child is actually having drowsiness in this regards, it is also an indicator of a CNS problem in this regards. Often we know that cerebroedema happens after a long period in the setting of DKA, usually after 6 to 12 hours of management. But in our country, because of inappropriate management, because of delayed diagnosis, cerebroedema can be present at diagnosis. So if you have a child who has unequal people, bradycardia or hypertension or any other feature of raised ICT, think of a possibility of cerebroedema in this regards. In terms of management, so in this regards to DKA management, we have got phases of sugar control, which basically in the initial phase, once we give the fluid, the sugar levels go down by around 200 mg per dl by just diluting the blood, along with stopping the counter-regulatory hormones. In the second phase, after 1 to 2 hours, we start adding insulin. That causes a gradual reduction as far as blood sugar levels are concerned. And finally, there is a time when insulin will cause the sugar levels to go below a particular level, but the hypoglycemia will be a risk, but acidosis would not have resolved by that time. And it is at this point we have to add both dextrose as well as insulin to continue as far as treatment is concerned. So in terms of management of DKA, we need to have a very intricate management with regards to the fluid, because on one hand, we don't want the child to be dehydrated, because dehydration per se can predispose to multiple factors in persistence of metabolic acidosis. But on the other hand, we don't want to give too much fluid, because that can cause cerebroedema. And if you give too much sodium chloride, there is a risk of developing hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis. So we need to balance fluid in terms of not giving too little or too much. And similarly for insulin, we don't want to give too little insulin so that the recovery is excessively prolonged. But we also don't want to give too much insulin so that there is a rapid fall of potassium or glucose, which may be lethal. So key here is keeping the right balance. And now we are talking about soft management in terms of giving time so that things are better over time in this perspective. So to start off, as far as fluid is concerned, we should give around 10 ml per kg bolus. And it may actually be avoided in somebody who has mild DKA, who doesn't have any hemodynamic instability. Please do not give multiple boluses. Maximum give 20 ml per kg. If a child is not improving, think of other possibilities and other causes which may be causative in this regards. Following that, we give an even correction over a period of around 48 to 72 hours. In children who are very sick, who have very high osmolality, consideration should be given for using around 72-hour correction in this regards. And key is that once you have made the fluid correction, just ensure that you're not giving more than 40 ml per kg in 4 hours, and your correction should not be more than twice maintenance in this regards. Regarding fluid also, if you have a small child, then using the formulas for maintenance using per kg body weight is helpful. But children beyond 40 to 50 kilograms, it's better to actually use the body surface area based 1.5 liter per meter square per day calculation for maintenance, which is much more desirable in this regard. Insulin management should only be started after the initial 1 to 2 hours of hydration, and it should be as a continuous IV infusion. Now we are talking about lesser doses being quite effective, but generally we can start off with 0.1 unit per kg per hour except for malnourished individuals and neonates where 0.05 unit per kg per hour is recommended. Multiple injections of IM rapid acting insulin of around 0.3 unit per kg are an option, but they need to be used only in situations where the other options are not available. Always flush the tubings once you are preparing insulin, because insulin can stuck to the tubings and therefore the delivery may be quite delayed, and the titration should be gradual as far as management of insulin is concerned. There is a significant potassium deficiency in every child with DKA. So potassium levels should actually be replaced in everybody unless there is anuria or hyperkalemia. If somebody has hypokalemia at diagnosis, please do not start insulin, because that will result in significant problem as far as hypokalemia is concerned. And replacement should be in the form of potassium chloride of around 40 millimoles per liter. And if despite all this the potassium levels are falling, think of reducing insulin, because reducing insulin and prolonging period of recovery may be a better way forward than actually causing much more severe hypokalemia in this regard. There comes a phase in management of DKA when sugars have resolved but acidosis is persisting, and in this regard, when the blood sugar levels are less than 270, one should add 5% dextrose, and once they become less than 200, then 10% dextrose should be added in this situation. Regarding alkali, there is no role as far as alkali in management of DKA, because soda bicarbonate causes cerebral edema, CNS acidosis, hypokalemia, and should be avoided with the exception of a situation of cardiorespiratory compromise in the setting of hyperkalemia. The clinical monitoring is of paramount importance, and every doctor should visit at least hourly as far as management is concerned for DKA. We should expect the heart rate to decrease with time, but if you have a significant decrease in heart rate, think of cerebral edema. Urine output should be normal, but if you have oliguria, that may be the first marker of renal failure, which is one of the most difficult and challenging situations to manage in DKA. And similarly, if you have deterioration in sensorium, think of hypoglycemia or diabetic ketoacidosis induced cerebral edema in that perspective. Laboratory monitoring should include the use of sodium levels, particularly the corrected sodium, which should rise. But if you have a rapid fall in sodium levels, then you should think of a risk factor suggestive of cerebral edema. Potassium levels are expected to fall with treatment, but if you have a rapid fall, then one needs to be very, very careful. Maybe add more potassium, make it 60 millimoles per liter, or reduce insulin dose, temporarily stop insulin if required. In that perspective, acidosis should improve, but if it's persistent, then there are a few things that we have to look at, like whether there is a lactic acidosis, whether insulin has been given properly, or there is a possibility of a hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis because of giving too much sodium chloride. Once the child is normal, the blood gas has improved, this child is conscious, eating, mealtime has happened, then we should think of transition. And it is always better to do it in the morning. There should be a significant overlap of at least 1 hour between subcutaneous and IV insulin. And now we know that if a long-acting insulin is given at night, it improves the course over time, and it may actually have a better impact as far as glycemic control over the next day or so. So now we'll go forward to illustrative cases of a 14-year-old boy with severe DKA who has a very high blood sugar with severe metabolic acidosis, potassium of 5 and weight of 30. So how do we plan? So we'll have to look at the airway, breathing and circulation and give 10 ml per kg of normal saline over 1 hour, following which we have to calculate the maintenance over 48 hours, which in this case happens to be 3.4 liters. We calculate the deficit at the rate of 10%, which becomes 3 liter, and then we add both and evenly distribute it over 48 hours along with potassium chloride, which should be 40 millimoles per liter at 140 ml per hour. So now with this treatment, at 4 hours, we started insulin also in between, but still the blood sugar is very high and base excess is also persistent. So what would be the cause of lack of response? This could be because the insulin dose is too little. So please always calculate insulin dose again. Best is to actually make 50 units in 50 ml of normal saline and give it according to the weight of 0.1 unit per kg per hour. It could be too dilute. So if you are giving using burette set, it may cause confusion in this regards. Insulin may be bound to the tubing. So flush around 10-15 ml of insulin and that will help you in this regards. And if the child is in refractory shock, he might not be responsive. So we need to be careful in that perspective. At 8 hours of treatment, now the sugars have come down, but the acidosis is persisting. So what should be done in this situation? Because we have persisting acidosis and the blood sugar has come down, we have to add dextrose in this setting, and it could be 5 to 10% depending on what the level of blood sugars. At 10 hours of treatment, the child actually, his blood sugar is normal, has metabolic acidosis, but potassium has now come down to 2.6. What to do? So he has persisting acidosis, blood sugar is normal, but once we have added dextrose, hypokalemia has happened. So in this perspective, one need to remember that the risk of persisting insulin and causing hypokalemia would be much worse compared to having some more time for this. Minus 11 base excess is not going to kill the child, but a potassium of 2 will. So best would be to actually either decrease insulin or stop insulin for some time, build up the potassium and then restart insulin in this perspective. 14 hours of treatment, the child suddenly becomes comatose with a blood sugar of 170. What could be the cause? So this is a child with severe DKA, rapid fluctuation in blood sugar, significant osmotic shift. The most likely diagnosis would be cerebral edema. Think hypoglycemia first. Correct hypoglycemia if it is present. Otherwise, start immediately with mannitol and don't wait for neuroimaging because that could be lethal. Once the child is stabilized, is not improving, you've done all the measures for cerebral edema, then we can think of other possibilities and do an imaging later on. So cerebral edema is a common situation. In resource poor countries, the figures are much higher than the 1 to 2% quoted as far as the Western countries are concerned. In our experience, it will be closer to 20 to 30%. High risk of mortality usually occur at 6 to 12 hours of treatment, but can happen at diagnosis or any time of treatment. So always be wary of cerebral edema in this setting. It's a clinical diagnosis, and in this situation, mannitol is something which will be life-saving in this regards. So always keep mannitol handy in a child who presents to you with severe metabolic acidosis and cerebral edema. 20 hours of treatment, the blood sugar is now normal. There is mild metabolic acidosis which is persisting. Ketones are negative. So this is not diabetic ketoacidosis anymore. Urine output is normal. So renal failure is out. There is no evidence of infection. So lactic acidosis becomes less likely. So what is the cause of persistent metabolic acidosis? And this could be a condition which we see quite often. So persistent metabolic acidosis in a child with DKA could be because of a situation of either persisting DKA, in which setting you will have a high urine gap, chloride will be normal and ketones will be positive, which is excluded in this situation. Could be lactic acidosis, in which again the anion gap will be high and chloride will be normal. Or most commonly will be hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis, in which the child is looking fine, There's no hemodynamic instability. The anion gap is normal. The chloride is high and ketones are negative. So if you have a persistent metabolic acidosis in a child with DKA who is otherwise fine, think of hyperchloremic metabolic acidosis, and this does not require continuation of treatment for a long time. If the renal functions are normal, the child will wash off all these acids and have a normalization over time. And this is something which we need to be very careful in this regards. 28 hours of treatment, blood sugar is now 170, base excess is also normal, child is conscious, what do you plan? Child was started orally, was given regular insulin, 0.3 units subcutaneously, and the insulin infusion was stopped. And lo and behold, 2 hours later, blood sugar is again 560. So what was the problem? There was no overlap which was given as far as the subcutaneous insulin is concerned. There should be a minimum gap of 1 hour between giving a subcutaneous insulin and stopping IV insulin in this regards, and maybe better to actually give a long-acting insulin a few hours before, because that could be helpful in this regards. So just to summarize management of DKA, the first step is to start hydration. Just give 10 ml per kg of normal saline, followed by the insulin management and give fluid including deficit and maintenance for a period of 48 hours. Start insulin at 0.1 unit per kg per hour. Add potassium in everybody unless there is anuria or potassium levels are more than 6 or there are ECG changes of hyperkalemia. And finally, once the blood sugar levels become less than 270, add dextrose. There is no role of soda bicarbonate, and always be wary of sevelidema. If you have a child with DKA who is worsening sensorially, check blood sugar. If normal, give mannitol, and that could be life-saving. Just to summarize, do not give insulin bolus, too much fluid or soda bicarbonate in DKA, but give potassium, monitor sodium, and always think of sevelidema in this regards.